Welcome back to Face the Nation. I'm Margaret Brennan. For some analysis on the situation surrounding this upcoming North Korea summit, we want to bring in Sumi Terry, who is with the Center for Strategic and International Studies, and Jean Lee, the former bureau chief in North Korea for the Associated Press. She is now with the Wilson Center here in Washington. Welcome to the show. It sounds like we are seeing the diplomacy build just in the past few hours, American diplomats meeting with North Koreans to hammer out whether or not this summit is actually going to happen. What do we read into this? Is this a sure thing at this point that President Trump and Kim meet June 12th?
I think it's highly likely because clearly President Trump wants this meeting. Kim Jong-un definitely wants this meeting. You can tell by the last statement that North Korea released, which was very conciliatory in tone for North Korean standards, personally praising Trump himself. And I've never seen it as a North Korea watcher. I've not seen North Korea actually praising a U.S. president. So I think both sides have true incentive to sit down. And I don't know if it's going to be June 12th, but I think it's going to happen.
It was interesting to hear former Director Clapper say he actually thought that this was good strategy, that letter that President Trump sent this week calling off the summit. Jean, is it? I mean, does this look like it's actually going to deliver what the president was asking for?
There's been so much uncertainty over the past week, and I think that what this past week has done is inject a bit of a reality check in this situation and forced all the partners in this circle to reinforce their commitment. And we're getting that. We're seeing that commitment from North Korea and South Korea. And now we have U.S. officials on the North Korean side of the DMZ, and there's no more concrete sign that this is going forward than having that group of, that team of three, as reported by the Washington Post, sitting down with the North Koreans to hammer out those details.
It looks like the nuts and bolts are still being worked out, Sumi, but we did hear from South Korea's president that Kim Jong-un wants more definite security assurances. What do you get that's more definite than President Trump saying, we're not looking for regime change?
Well, North Korea is not going to trust our words, and I'm not even sure if a piece of paper is going to guarantee regime security. What North Koreans meant traditionally by regime security is end of U.S.-South Korea alliance. They usually talked about troop presence in South Korea, U.S. troop presence in South Korea. I'm not sure if North Korea is going to demand that, but what they're looking for is a peace treaty, normalization of relations between Pyongyang and Washington.
Now, you spent a number of years at the CIA on this portfolio. We're now seeing American diplomats in the driver's seat. Veteran diplomat today, Sung Kim, meeting with the North Koreans. What does that say to you? What changes now that we move from intelligence to diplomacy?
Well, I'm not sure if intelligence is completely cut off. I'm sure just Sung Kim has been brought on because he has experience of dealing with North Koreans. But I think what he will be seeking for is clarity on denuclearization, because we've been talking about how there's a different definition of denuclearization. So far from North Korea and Washington, we are talking about unilateral disarmament of North Korea's nuclear weapons program. North Korea always talked about it in a broader sense of the Korean Peninsula. So I'm sure he's looking for clarity to make sure that when Trump sits down with Kim Jong-un, we have not as a wide gap that we had before.
Jean, you lived in Pyongyang for some time while you were bureau chief there. Did it surprise you when you heard North Korea outright reject these offers of financial help from the United States, private investment, as Secretary Pompeo described it?
I think that is a face-saving way to... they were insulted by these suggestions by the National Security Advisor and by the Vice President that they are doing this out of desperation. North Korea does not want to be portrayed as a poor, desperate country. They're saying, listen, we have a nuclear arsenal, a verifiable nuclear arsenal. We want to come to this meeting as an equal. And so it was a way to tell their people as well, you can maintain your sense of pride, but I do think they're going to be looking for economic concessions. And I think President Moon is the one who stated that language very carefully, said economic cooperation. And that is perhaps the language that you use when you talk about it with the North Koreans.
What you're saying is the rhetoric and the words chosen here really matter. And
Precisely.
We've seen the rhetoric at different points in the White House timetable and look very different depending on who it's coming from, Pompeo versus National Security Advisor Bolton.
But even Pompeo, when he said, North Korea, you too can eat meat. I think that was a very insulting phrase. You too, North Korea, can become like South Korea if you denuclearize. And of course, because Kim Jong-un is very into face, he's thin-skinned person, he cares very much about how he's perceived. So I think that rhetoric does matter. How we send this message does matter very much.
So in the messaging that you've seen from President Trump, he seems very eager to have this summit happen. But he is not someone who sticks to a diplomatic script. You're saying that has where it's worked against him. Has it been in his favor in some ways to be this unpredictable?
Well, I think the last, when President Trump canceled the summit, I think that did take North Koreans by surprise. I don't think North Koreans are used to U.S. president acting this way. So that kind of unpredictability, I do think, sent a message to North Korea that they have to be careful here, too, because we are dealing with unpredictability on both sides.
But the North Koreans all along have used his unpredictability as an opportunity. I think when he was campaigning for president and he said back then that he would sit down with Kim Jong-un, that the North Koreans paid attention to that. And they said, here's a president for the first time who is not playing by the book, and let's take advantage of that. Let's grab this opportunity.
North Korea has multiple nuclear sites, according to U.S. intelligence, some of them underground. The fact that they blew up this one site and invited in reporters, is this a typical script? Is this theater? What do we make of this?
We've seen this before, and that's important to keep in mind. It was 10 years ago when North Korea brought foreign journalists to its nuclear site in Yongbyon and blew up a cooling tower. Very dramatic images. And then, of course, secretly started enriching uranium. And so it is show, it is theater, but it's also meant as a sign, an expression of their commitment to denuclearization. And they will use that to say, look, look what we've done. We want to show you. We have proof that we're committed to this.
So I think it's a long way to go before we get to a complete irreversible dismantlement of North Korea's nuclear program, because it is still reversible. And you're talking about tunnels. North Korea has hundreds of thousands of underground tunnels. So a verifiable part is going to be the very challenging issue for us.
Thank you both very much. We'll be right back with the head of the Conservative House Freedom Caucus, Mark Meadows. Stay with us.